Simon & Schuster Audio presents Star Trek, Spectre, by William Shatner, with Judith Reeves-Stevens and Garfield Reeves-Stevens. Read by William Shatner.
Kate leaned forward on the small table in the bar on Deep Space Nine. The Vulcan female across from her slipped her a small pad. He's still alive. Kate palmed the flat device, cupped her hand around its small display, and activated it. She gasped as she recognized the face that appeared. James Tiberius Kirk. When was this image recorded? The Vulcan whispered. A year ago. During the Virgin crisis, Kirk was arrested by port authorities on Vulcan. This is from a magistrate's hearing. Instantly, Kate did the math. Kirk's birth date in the Earth year 2233 would be forever burned in her memory. T'Val, that's impossible. This man is no more than 60 at most, but Kirk, today he'd be 142 years old. The Vulcan, T'Val, sipped her water, using the moment to glance around the bar. 82 years ago, Kirk was presumed lost during the maiden voyage of a new starship from Earth. But in actuality, he was caught in a non-linear temporal continuum. 4 years ago, Kirk was discovered within that continuum by Starfleet Captain Jean-Luc Picard. Kate's eyes widened. How could such a thing be possible? Even here? T'Val continued. After that, Kirk was once again thought to have perished almost immediately on the backwater planet where Picard retrieved him. But a year later, to everyone's surprise, he returned. A Romulan faction had used Borg technology to... The Vulcan searched for the correct terminology as Kate hazarded a guess. To bring him back to life? T'Val shook her head. Logic dictates that because he lives today, he did not die then. And now, he has withdrawn from all contact with the universe at large to a world named Chow. Kate was intrigued. Chal? Isn't that a Klingon word? The Vulcan nodded. Yes, it means heaven. The one place where no one would expect to find Kirk. The colony on Chal was established more than a century ago by the Klingons and Romulans. Kate stared down at the image of Kirk on the pad. In a way, I hope he doesn't cooperate. I think I would enjoy killing him. She looked up at T'Val. Maybe after he's helped us, you and I can kill him anyway. Sooner or later, James Tiberius Kirk must die. His shadow stretched before him in the blazing light of Chal's twin suns, but James T. Kirk stood alone. For a year, he had known that this day would come. Victory or ignominious defeat, all or nothing. It was the way Kirk liked it. With a sharp intake of breath, Kirk wrapped his arms around the wrinkled gray covering of his enemy, the beast that had relentlessly mocked him all through the year. His muscles strained, sweat poured from him, and then a band of fire shot through his lower back like a phaser burst, and he collapsed to the soil of Chow, gasping in agony. James T. Kirk's back had gone out. Again. And the malevolent tree stump, that last gnarled obstacle in the field he had cleared, the field where his new house would be built and his garden planted, remained in place, mocking him still. He lay there for an endless time, finger tapping the soil. 3 years ago, the field had been like any other part of Chow's legendarily beautiful tropical islands, a slice of paradise, an Eden. 2 years ago, the planet's plant life had been deliberately exposed to a virogen which had reduced Chal's islands to an apocalyptic landscape of brown stubble and withered yellow vegetation. But then in that same year, Kirk had returned to this world 8 decades after his supposed death during the maiden voyage of the Enterprise B. With Spock and McCoy and Captain Jean-Luc Picard and his new generation of Starfleet's finest, Kirk had discovered the conspiracy that had inflicted that hideous act of environmental terrorism on the worlds of the Federation. McCoy came up with an antivirogen, and the ecosystems of 100 worlds were now being restored through their own natural healing processes. So he had once again returned to Chao and to his love, Telani. The spaceman had hung up his rockets to find a simpler life, and he had found it in this small patch of forest. A year ago, Telani at his side, her hand in his, their hearts entwined, Kirk had stood in this clearing. Telani had looked into his eyes.
"You're right, James. We'll build here. A house. A home."
And so in this field, Kirk had toiled. Where once he had roamed the galaxy, now he seldom strayed farther than the small cabin he shared with Telani. At that moment, Telani rode into the clearing, her white wrap billowing from her as she sat bareback in Iowa Dream. The horse was a spectacular animal, a gift from Picard. Kirk didn't even bother to try to stand. He knew he couldn't make it. And he could see the look of amusement on Telani's lovely face as she realized why he remained seated on the ground. Telani expertly dismounted and walked over to him, her bare feet sinking into the rich soil of Chao. She glanced at the stump.
"The beast still mocks you."
"It started to move." Telani gave him a knowing smile.
"But your back moved more?"
Kirk's face admitted the truth. Telani held out both hands to him, and keeping his back rigid, he pulled himself up. His lips were only centimeters from hers, and each detail of her appearance only served to entrance him once again. Her unique heritage thoroughly concealed the fact that she had lived for more than a century. Her hair, tied back for riding, was even more silver than Kirk's, though to his eyes it was as if she were wreathed in stars. From the subtle ridges of her brow, past an eye and across one cheek, the angry slash of a virgin scar still flared. Whether it was the Klingon in her that made her choose to wear the blemish to her beauty with honor, or that she had come to understand that outward appearances meant nothing when measured against those qualities that dwelt within a warrior's heart, Kirk didn't know, and he didn't care.
"James, 5 minutes at the clinic could take care of that for the next year."
"I'll keep doing my exercises. No more protoplasms, no more force field readjustments."
Telani tapped his forehead.
"No more sense."
He took her hand, kissed her finger. Then Telani lightly traced her fingers down the opening of Kirk's tunic.
"I love you, James, but I'll never understand you."
Kirk took her errant hand before it could distract him further.
"Why?"
"Because of the way you deny your past."
"I don't deny it."
"You do deny it, James. You've fought gods, you've changed the course of history, and after all that, you've spent the last year of your life doing battle with a tree stump you could deal with in a second with a phaser."
Kirk gazed around, seeing all his dreams in perfect completion.
"This is my home." "Your home will always be a place to return to, James. If you don't go now, the restlessness and frustration will build in you, fester in you, until one day you will wake up and it will be all or nothing again. Then you'll turn your back on Chao and on me."
"Telani, will you come with me?"
"Have you heard a single word I've said?"
She gave a tug to the drawstring of his tunic, pulling it open.
"I have a plan, James. You might be leaving Chao, but you will always be here with me."
He cradled her head in his hands, kissed her head ridges, the points of her ears, inhaled the fragrant scent of her sun-warmed hair.
"I like this plan of yours, but maybe with my back this isn't the right time."
She smiled at him, lips parted.
"Leave that to me. As someone once said, resistance is futile."
Kirk laughed. He knew Telani was right. He needed to venture out into the universe again. But his secret fear was there were no more challenges out there for him to face. The Federation was at peace. What need could the universe have for a hero whose time had passed? Jean-Luc Picard looked at the bridge's virtual main screen, where the golden discontinuity was displayed in all its writhing, multicolored glory. Flashes of anti-proton energy, appearing to be little more than lightning strikes despite their solar system size scale, flickered across the billowing plasma storms. Admiral Alina Nechayev at Starbase 310 had insisted that the Enterprise be assigned to the Golden Discontinuity. Starfleet scientists had recently begun to analyze the nature of space-time around the Bajoran system. As a result, several intriguing theories concerning the Badlands, a region of space near the Cardassian border, filled with plasma storms, had been developed. It might be possible, both Starfleet and Cardassian scientists had concluded, that the presence of a Badlands-type section of space...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.